All right, so we need to dive right in and make sure. So where we left off a week and a half ago was on buffer overflows. So we covered a number of attacks, and your next homework assignment, you will be trying to find vulnerabilities in programs. We'll talk about that on Wednesday, so sit tight. That'll be an individual homework assignment. So, and part of being successful there is studying one of the most classic security problems today, which is buffer overflows or overwrites. So it's actually an incredibly common vulnerability. So we're going to kind of look at it historically and look at the progression of buffer overflows, and specifically not only how to find them, but how to exploit them to gain code execution inside of a process. So, and as we'll see, we'll then kind of ratchet up the security mechanisms. So we'll say, okay, what about ASLR now? How do we get around that? And what about a non-executable stack? How do we get around that? But for now, so we're taking kind of a historical approach here. But this still, you know, even though we're looking at binaries without all of these fancy protection mechanisms, A, there's a lot of binaries out there that run on routers or other embedded devices that don't have these security mechanisms, so these are incredibly common. And B, even most of the heap overflows, all of these memory corruption style vulnerabilities all stem from the same idea of overriding bounds in memory. So it's incredibly important to understand the basics, because having, you know, you gotta walk before you can run, right? So, I feel like I already did all this. Okay, so, yes. Okay, so, but in order to understand what a buffer overflow or overflow is, we first need to completely understand the stack. So, I need my... All right, so the stack is essentially scratch memory for function, but more specifically, what is the stack, and how does it differ from a stack?
The stack is actually memory. It's memory, right? A stack is a data structure, abstract.
Yeah, so a stack is the abstract data type of a stack. What are the operations you have on a stack?
Push and pop.
Push and pop, in what order do things come out in?
First in, last out.
Yeah, first in, last out, right? You push things on, you pop things off, right? As long as you get the order straight in your head. So the stack in a program is specifically a memory location, so it's going to be actually a segment of memory that's defined in the ELF header sections, which we saw, that allows a program essentially scratch memory. So why does a program need scratch memory? In other words, why don't we know in advance exactly how much memory a program uses and just allocate that and use it?
Dynamic based on the input data.
Dynamic, so the input data could vary, right? Depending on if you're parsing a 1 megabyte file versus a gigabyte file. What else? What if your data size is completely constant?
Function calls.
What was that? Function calls. Why do you need scratch memory for function calls?
Because it puts the arguments and the return address on the stack.
It does that. Do you need a scratch memory location to do that?
Because you don't know how many function calls.
You don't know how many function calls, right? So you got to remember, every function call, as we'll see, right, has to execute. And then after a function is done executing, what happens? Does the program just terminate? No, that would be a horrible way to program. What happens when a function is done executing? It returns where? To the function that, or specifically the code that called it. So right after it gets called, that's where it returns. Right? A function can be called from 100 different places in a program, but when it only returns to that specific place where it was called. And this changes depending on the runtime of the function. So you can have, and then you can also, when you think about starting from the beginning of the program, all the functions that execute, can you have multiple instances of the same function on the call stack? I.e., can you have a function call itself? That calls itself, that calls itself, right? But you need memory for all of those things, because each of those functions, if they have local variables, have their own local memory. So the stack is the answer to all these questions. It's essential, it's actually a very basic component of low-level architectures. And it starts at a high memory address and grows down, and we are going to draw the stack like normal people, where we're going to start at all Fs at the top and go down to all zeros. Yes?
I would say the stack, that's architecture dependent with respect to the starting from a low memory, high memory, go down.
Yes, that part is the how the stack operates. It needs to start one way and go one way, right? Just like you push things on, it goes, in this case, down, and you pop and it goes up. But yes, definitely architecture dependent.
And it's architecture dependent on how, what the ISA, like ARM or x86 or MIPS, gives you in terms of manipulating the stack. So for instance, x86 has a built-in push operation, which takes the value of the register, pushes it onto the stack, and decrements the stack pointer.
There's a dedicated stack pointer register, whereas other languages, you have to manage it yourself, but you can still do it. It's the same idea.
So, and this is super important. So in x86, the register ESP holds the address of the top of the stack, right? So these ideas are very closely linked. The stack doesn't exist without whatever values inside ESP, and the value inside ESP dictates where the stack is. So if I tell you the stack is at location 1000, then you know that inside the ESP register is the value what? 1000. Yeah, it has to be. Otherwise it doesn't make sense. So there's two basic instructions here, push and pop. They have very specific semantics. These are things that you should just drill into your head because it's not hard stuff. You guys can all learn and remember this. Push EAX means to decrement the stack pointer, so change the ESP register, then store the value inside the register EAX onto the stack. So pop does completely the opposite. So pop is going to, working backwards, takes the value off of where ESP is pointing to, copies it into a register. So for instance, pop EAX takes the value where ESP is pointing to, puts it into EAX, and then increments the stack. Good? Stack experts?
You say increment because it's building down or not, correct?
Increment, yes. Increment going down. So when adding things, you're decrementing the stack, and when you increment, you're going up the stack. We'll see examples like this. So stack example, all Fs at the top. Clearly, you could draw this either way. You could start at zero. It makes a lot more sense going down. I don't know why. I think I just looked at it so much. Anytime I look at it the reverse way, it just looks wrong. And I've even heard of some monsters who start the stack on the left and it grows to the right. That's completely not correct. So the idea is, just like we said, if the stack pointer is pointing somewhere inside the stack at memory location 10,000 in hex, this means that I must have, okay, well, I guess I don't have that there. This means that the stack pointer must have the value 10,000 hex inside there. So even just off of this point of having, okay, the stack pointer is pointing, has the value 10,000 hex, which means the current top of the stack is at 10,000 hex. What do we know about the memory addresses that are greater than that? What was it?
It's filled with functions or...
Say it again?
It's filled with function calls or probably data.
Use data, right? It's use data. Because we know that anything that if 10,000 hex is the quote-unquote top, although top here is tricky because it's keep going down, is the top of the stack. And if we add things by decrementing and going down the stack, then if we increment going up the stack pointer means that we're now into memory that is being used, right? These are things that have been pushed onto the stack. So conversely, what do we know about the things that are lower than 10,000 hex?
Garbage,
right? Is it all zeros? No, not necessarily. We actually don't. As we saw, the pushing and popping things off the stack only changes the stack pointer and maybe puts values on there. But when you pop things off, you don't erase what was there. So you have garbage, which could be, in some cases, it could be useful garbage, depending on what you're trying to do. We'll get into that later. So if we have the instructions, push EAX, and then pop EBX, and so then if we have our registers, we think of, okay, what's the value inside EAX? Let's say it's the value hex A. We have edx, it has the value, let's say, 0. And we know, because we talked about it, that the value inside the ESP register is 10,000 hex. If that's not the case, we've completely messed up. So when I'm going to put an arrow on push EAX. This means that essentially you think that the program counter, or in x86 it's called the EIP, the extended instruction pointer, is pointing to that value, which means the next instruction to be executed is that value. So if you're in GDB, you put a breakpoint there, it means that when you do SI for step instruction, it's going to execute that one instruction and stop on the next instruction. So it's going to do push EAX. So what's going to happen? It's going to what? Decrement the stack pointer by how much? 1? Is it going to be hex? Well, that's not right. I was going to say 9999, but that's wrong.
4 bytes.
4 bytes? Why 4 bytes?
Yeah, it has to push. The register is 4 bytes large, right? The register is 32 bits, which is the same as 4 bytes. It has to store onto the stack enough value for EAX, so it has to decrement the stack pointer by 4. So this would be FFFC. And then, which then moves our pointer down, our imaginary. Remember, this blue pointer is just imaginary. Which what the blue pointer that was at 10,000 hex now moves down to FFFC, because that's what's inside ESP, right? Then what happens? So are we done executing this? No, what do we have to do?
Store it.
Yes, we need to store. So we only did half of our push EAX instruction, right? We decremented the stack pointer, and now we need to copy hex A, which actually we just talked about. It's 4 bytes, so it's going to be 000A, or maybe with the endianness, A000. I don't actually know. But when we look at it as an integer, we will interpret those 4 bytes as OXA, which is 10. Okay, now we're done. Now we've executed that instruction. Now we do pop EDX, so what happens? Increment it? What do we do? What was the order that we did it on a push?
We moved
and then stored. So when we pop, we need to do completely the opposite. So copy it into the register. So copy whatever's at FFFC and copy those 4 bytes into the register EDX, which will change that to XA, and then increment the stack pointer by 4. So now the stack pointer is going to point up at, yes, up at 10,000 hex. And just like we said, does anything, so that memory that we put onto the stack still remains in memory, that XA at FFFC. But in our program's mind, it's considered garbage, right? We can reuse and overwrite that address at will. So what was the equivalent? What essentially did I do semantically here with these two instructions?
Copy.
Copy what?
You copied kind of swapping, so you moved value from A to B.
Yep. So tricky that it's not a swap. I think swap would actually switch both of them. But yes, we essentially moved EAX into EDX, right? So, and that's the stack. So this is the basic idea, and if you can really understand this and conceptualize this on a deep level, you will find all of these stack-based and actually all these memory corruption and overflow vulnerabilities a lot easier. So one of the main uses of the stack is what we talked about of having function frames. So somebody who's taking compiler, refresh us as what is a function frame? It's like a picture you put around your awesome function that you wrote.
It's arguments plus local variables at the base pointer.
Yeah, it's essentially everything that a function needs to execute, right? And so when you're writing C code, if you want memory, how do you get memory? So if you want, let's say, 10,000 bytes of memory, how do you get that 10,000 bytes?
Malloc.
So you can call malloc. And then what do you have to do with those 10,000 bytes when you want to free them?
Free.
You call free. As we'll see, these are libc functions you're calling into, malloc and free. But So how come when you declare in your function, so you're writing a function in C, this is your function foo, and then you're declaring a character buffer of 10,000 characters. You put char, bracket, 10,000, bar. Do you have to malloc that?
No.
Do you have to free that? Why not?
Because we asked for it already, so that was an implicit ask.
Yeah, so we've asked for this as part, so it's a local variable of the function, which means that variable, the lifetime of that variable is only during that function's execution. When that function returns, that data is already not used. When we malloc 10,000 bytes, we're specifically telling the computer, I will worry about how long this memory is valid for, and I will be responsible for freeing it after I'm done. Because maybe you return that 10,000 bytes or that pointer to the 10,000 bytes from that function, which gets passed to another function while you're using it, right? If you only need that 10,000 bytes for one function, then why use malloc? The reason would be if you don't know the size in advance and you need to dynamically get the size, but that's another issue. So, yes?
And one of them goes in the stack and the other one goes in the heap as well.
Yes, essentially that's the main difference. And the key reason is understanding that local variables don't need to be on the heap, but are on the heap for essentially performance reasons, as we'll see. It's incredibly easy to free these variables, whereas the heap has to do a lot more management. So the idea is, could you use, let's say, the stack pointer to say, okay, the stack pointer,
another question is, so, okay, we can say we can use the stack to store local variables, but when I write a function and I have my local variables of int a and character b and my huge array that we just called bar, right? How does the compiler actually compile that out so that every reference to a, b, or c grabs that local variable from my stack?
Repeat that one more time, please.
Yeah, so you're a compiler. You are seeing that I have this function defined, that I have variables A, B, and C, and local variables, and you see that I have A is equal to A plus B. How do you translate that out into assembly code? Yeah.
It would be offset from like EBP or be allocated at by the compiler or ESP.
Yeah, so one thing is I could try to use the stack pointer as an offset, right? I could say, okay, so I'll know ahead of time exactly how many bytes, so each function uses a different but known at compile time number of bytes. For instance, like with an int, we know it's 4 bytes. I mean, you can just run sizeof on all of these data structures to see what you need. And so you could maybe change the stack and then just say, okay, a fixed offset from the stack is always A, and here is variable B at a different offset. Why is that not a good idea?
Because doesn't it change when you push and pull?
Exactly. The stack changes during function execution because of pushes and pops. Right? Because how many registers roughly do we have? Or does anybody know exactly the answer? I'm asking a question I don't know the answer to. I think it's like,
you mean like spaces?
General purpose registers.
Six.
So what if I'm doing this complex calculation that involves multiple, let's say 10 intermediate values and variables, which is more than the registers that I have. Do I just give up? No, I store stuff on the stack. Right? I'm the compiler. I can store temporary variables on the stack, and I know exactly where they are, and I can pop them off when necessary. So for this reason, we don't want to use the stack pointer, an offset from the stack pointer, because the stack pointer is constantly changing. So this is where the idea of the base pointer comes into. So it's called base pointer in x86. The other way of thinking about it is the frame pointer. So it points to a fixed location inside the frame of the function. And then each local variable will be different offsets from that frame pointer. So I would say, I know that A will always be at EBP. Which direction would it be? Down, it should be down, right? We'll see why in a second, but it'll be EBP minus 4 will be A, and EBP minus 8 will be B, and EBP minus, 10,004 will be my huge buffer bar. So this value, EBP, is current, just like the stack pointer, ESP, it holds the current value of the current function's function pointer. So now we're going to go through a actually real example of a C program, a small C function that I've compiled so you can see these different things. So here I have int main, I have int A, int B, float C. So these are all local variables declared in this function. I'm going to set A equals to 10, B equals 100, C is equal to 10.45, A is equal to A plus B, and return 0. Right? So we go through, and we're a compiler. Right? So we need to basically calculate fixed offsets for A, B, and C. So I'm going to, and can we have, let's say if we have A and B, which are both ints, can I have A at EDP minus 4 and B at EDP minus 6? Why not? Because they're 4 bytes, those would be overlapping bytes. That actually would be an interesting problem, but yeah, that would be very bad, right? You have, I mean, that would cause massive problems. So I can say that A is at EDP plus A, and as we'll see, it's going to be a negative number, EDP plus B, EDP plus C, and then I can easily translate each of these instructions. I can say, well, set the memory at EDP plus A to 10, right? Roughly, this is pseudocode, not real assembly code. Similarly, set the memory at EDP plus B to 100, set the memory at EDP, whatever, and then so on and so forth. Set the memory of EDP plus A is equal to the memory of EDP plus A plus the memory of EDP plus B. And then when this gets compiled out, this actually is very straightforward. So the compiler, and depending on your compiler options, depending on the compiler version, depending on, I don't know, the cycle of the moon or something, like you'll get different results for the x86 assembly here. So in this example, EBP, it said A is at minus C, so minus 12, B is at EBP minus 8, and C is at EBP minus 4. Just where it decided to put things. So I'm going to ignore the prologue for now, but the exact code of this is a move constant A into EBP minus C. Right? This is essentially the x86 assembly instruction that's exactly equivalent to this pseudocode we have. And similarly, move hex 64 into EBP minus 8, which is B, and move, what's this crazy value? It's hex 41273333 into EAX.
10.45.
Yeah, it's 10.45 in IEEE floating point format.
Right.
So then we move EAX. So why is this two instructions and not one? The second instruction is move EAX into EDP minus 4. Yes, why two instructions? The other two instructions were just one instruction. Move 10 into EDP minus C. Yeah?
Tries to build a value from that address to the EAX.
There's no dereference. If there's a dereference around EAX, then we have that. So there's no dereference. So it's moving literally hex 41273333 into EAX. And then that value is then moved into EDP minus 4. So no dereferencing of that value. Good guess, yeah.
Is there a limit to the size of immediates when moving into memory?
Yes. So actually the real answer, well, the answer if anyone asks you why a compiler does something, it's because the compiler decided to do it that way. So we'll see many examples of that when the compiler chooses one instruction over a semantically equivalent instruction. And the answers of why, this is why things change over time. The reason in this case is because you think this instruction has to be translated out into x86 code. So there's a limit when you want to use an immediate instruction. If you want to use an immediate move instruction with an immediate value of like, because that A has to be inside your instruction, right? So move that into EBP minus C, you know, you have to specify that it's a move instruction. You have to specify the immediate value. You have to specify that you want EBP with a minus C displacement. So if you want to specify the whole 32 bits, this hex 41273333, that's already a long instruction. That's already 4 bytes of your instruction plus the move and then the target register. So you can't actually move a huge value directly into memory location. So
Yeah, but you know, the compiler could choose to do this in 100 different ways, so it just chose to do it this way. All right. Oh, okay. So then we can see that move. So EBP minus 4 into EAX. So that's C. Move EAX into EBP minus 8. So that's doing.
It's the other way.
Yes, it's the other way. Move EIAX. Sorry, I got those confused. You're right. Okay. So take B. Move it into EAX. Add EAX to EBP minus C and store it where? In EBP minus C, yeah, onto the A value. And that's it. And that's the body of our function. So and then we can step through this. I'm going to do this pretty quickly because I don't want to get too bogged down in the details here, but feel free. You know, you should be able to walk through each of these instructions and draw and think about how the stack is changing. And it may seem silly, but this is something that I do on almost every like CTF challenge where I have a stack and I need to figure out, okay, where am I and where am I overwriting and what else is above me? Like, drawing it out really helps me every single time. So, okay, so the idea is, so this function starts executing. So we know the stack pointer is at 10,000 hex because I told you that it is, and it is in this diagram. But we know it is because 10,000 hex is inside the register ESP. What's currently in the EBP register? How did we get here? Not here in this room. And not like, don't rethink all your life choices that brought you here to this room on this Monday, but. How did we get to start executing this move instruction? Yeah.
From previous function.
Yeah, somebody else called us. So even though we're the main function, if you look at this, there's actually a lot of things that happen in your binary before you actually get to the main function. So somebody else called us. So what's inside EBP? The previous function that calls us base pointer. So, yeah, okay, so before, sorry, this clicker's not working there. Okay, so before we get here, right, we don't know what's inside EBP. Maybe it's something above us. I'm actually missing all the prologue here, and now I'm upset about that, but we'll get to it later. So what we need to do is set up our pointer, our base pointer, right? Because we need it for all those offsets we just calculated. So we know right now the top of the stack is free. So we're gonna move our stack pointer into the base pointer. So now we're going to just copy the value that's in the stack pointer and copy it into the base pointer. So that's gonna put 10,000 hex into EBP, which means now we have two blue arrows, one at 10,000 hex for the stack pointer, the other 10,000 hex for the base pointer. Was this in any way involved in any of the instructions that we actually wrote? No, did we say we want the base pointer? No, we just said we want A to be 10 and B to be 100 and A to be A plus or C to be that 10.45 and A is equal to A plus B. Right? But as we'll see, the program has to have this prologue in order to set up the stack correctly so it can execute. So the next instruction is a sub hex 10, so 16 from ESP. So it's going to move the stack pointer down 16 bytes, essentially doing what for our function? Space for local variables, exactly. It's essentially allocating 16 bytes on the stack for this function. How does it know 16? Yeah, the compiler decided that it needed 16 bytes. So it needed, so we had A and B, so are both 4, so 8 bytes, plus C is a float. How many is that? Another, a float is 4 bytes, a double is 8, I think. Pretty sure. Whatever, we'll say it's 4. So we have 444. 12, so we're at 12. So how come it gave us 16 bytes?
A is equal to A plus B.
What?
The addition operation?
But we store it directly onto the stack where A is. What was that?
Where it is.
The compiler decides. So it's actually a, for historical reasons, some architectures couldn't access or execute memory or something on a non-4-byte boundary. And so the compilers usually try to make sure that these things like stack pointers end up on 4-byte boundaries. So, I don't know. But it's not necessary. I mean, you could write a compiler that did this, or your compiler could decide that that variable C that we have is never used. Right? We just set C to be 10.45 and never use it, so it could completely optimize that out. So there could actually be less space on the stack than we think based on looking at the C code. Which is important as to why we always look at the assembly code. Like the C code can lie to you because you can think though that things are on the stack this way, but the compiler is the ultimate decide. The compiler ultimately decides what goes where. Okay. So we subtract then 10 in hex, which is 16 from the stack pointer, which means that ESP now points down at FFF0, while the base pointer still points up at 10,000 hex. We then are going to move 10 at EBP minus C, which is going to be at what, FFF4, and then we're going to move hex 64 to EBP minus 8. We're then going to move that crazy 10.45 and floating point into EAX, and then move that from EAX into EBP minus 4. And then, okay, so now on the stack we can see the exact memory locations of our local variables A, B, and C on the stack. And now we actually do the calculation, so then we take EBP minus 8, which is the B variable, which is hex 64. We're going to move that into EAX. We're then going to add EAX, which is 64, with EBP minus C, which is going to be FFF4, which is our variable A. And so that's going to add 64 to A, which is going to be whatever hex 110 is. And then we're done executing. So you should be able to take this code and draw this stack. And I say, what's the stack like at this location? Or this location, right? This is a key skill. All right, cool. So brief review for some, or introduction to function frames. But as we talked about earlier, function frames aren't, yeah.
I just wanted to ask, sure. Do you know the time frame for the exams yet?
No, that's a good question, but I'll decide very soon. But not before spring break.
I'll say not right after, but we'll see. That's a good question. Okay. I threw me off track. Okay, yes. So, we talked about this. So we need local variables which need to be stored on the stack. What other information does a function need when it gets called?
Arguments.
The arguments to the function. How does the function return its value to the function that called it?
Right? What was that? Yeah, so we need a return value, we need parameters. We'll need, as we see, well, this is a little fun. We need, first of all, the other thing we need is a breadcrumb. We need the return address, right? Because every instruction, essentially, you can think of it has complete exclusive access to the CPU. So when the CPU does not know that it's inside of a function executing, right? That's just an illusion that we've created. All it knows is I'm gonna parse that next instruction, I'm gonna do whatever it says, I'm gonna execute it, and I'm gonna go on to the next one, and I'm just gonna keep doing this over and over again, because that's what I do, that's my job. So when we finally get to the end of a function, we talked about, there's 100 invocations of the function foo in the program. Which is the function that we actually return to. So we need, I think of it as a breadcrumb or some way to say, hey, this is where you go after you're done executing. So the return address. And local variables and temporary variables, as we saw. So the stack is super handy and used all the time. So this is all in an abstract way. This is all information that a function needs in order to not only execute properly, but to return to whoever is calling it and give those values.
how those values are passed and expressed. Do you push the arguments on the stack? Do you put the arguments in variables? Or sorry, not variables, there are no variables. Do you put the arguments in registers? What does a calling function guarantee about certain registers? Does it say that it won't change certain registers? Does it say that registers can be changed when the function is called? All of this is, there's no technical reason that one is better than the other. I mean, maybe they were back when these things were first designed. But essentially, this is why the important part here is a convention. It's a convention that if you follow this convention, you can call a C program. Which is actually how you can do super cool things like call a C function from Python code. Because Python knows how to call into that C code, and it can do that and then transform the values back. And you can even do the same thing as Java. You can call from Java into C code because of this calling convention. So this is also something you need to burn into your brain. I mean, don't hurt yourselves, but this is something that is incredibly important is this calling convention. And so actually the must be stored on the stack is actually a misnomer. It doesn't have to be stored on the stack. The calling convention that we're talking about will. So, and the important thing is the convention varies based on the processor. So different architectures have different calling conventions, x86 versus ARM. Different operating systems, so you have the same, so x86, the calling convention is different on Linux than it is in Windows. The compiler is kind of, but the type of call, so when calling, even in Linux, so Linux, x86, if you're calling another function, you use the cdecl calling convention, which we're looking at, but if you're calling into the kernel, into a syscall, you use a different calling convention. I think it's just called the syscall calling convention, but I actually don't know. So these are all different, and so you need to, you know, you need to know what the language essentially that you're speaking is, otherwise you can't call a function. So this is the main one we're gonna look at, is the cdecl calling convention. So the caller has to do these things in this order, otherwise everything breaks. And this is, again, arbitrary, the ordering, all this stuff, but it's like learning any kind of standard, like IP or TCP that you learned. Like, it's not given down to us on high. People came up with this and decided, yes, we'll use this. So the caller pushes the arguments onto the stack in right to left order. So think of the stack moving down. So the rightmost argument will be the first argument pushed onto the stack. The next argument underneath that will be the second to right, all the way to the leftmost argument is the last argument pushed onto the stack. So the nice thing about this is it allows you to have functions with any number of arguments, right? Because you can just keep pushing, as long as you got the memory, you can keep pushing arguments onto the stack. So why right? I mean, there actually is a good reason for right to left, but I don't want to get into it now. So think about why right to left as opposed to left to right. So the next one is they push the address of the instruction after the call. So this is used as that breadcrumb. So this is when the function that we're calling is done executing, it knows where to jump to after it's done. And that's it. That's all you have to do to call a function. You just do this stuff, bang, call, good. The callee, the person who's getting called, or the person, it's a function, but the function that gets called has to, as part of its interaction here, has to save the previous frame pointer because they're going to create their own base pointer. So they need to save the base pointer of the person before them because we can see in this calling convention, the caller doesn't have to worry about the base pointer, right? The caller doesn't have to save it, the callee has to. So the callee pushes the previous frame pointer onto the stack, then creates space for all the local variables, and then after program execution, ensures that the stack is consistent upon return. Why is that important?
Because the caller doesn't know.
Yeah, I don't want to care anything about the implementation details of your function. I don't care if this function uses 10 memory, bytes on a stack versus 1,000 versus 1,000,000. As long as you give it back to me, the stack, in exactly the same place as when I left it, then I'm good and I'm super happy. So yeah, there's a lot of interesting kind of design decisions at each of these levels about abstraction and how much, if you want to call a function, what information do you need? And puts the return value into the EAX register. So this is how a function returns a value from one function to the next. Cool. Questions? Yes?
All the registers value are stored in the stack before...
Say it again?
All the registers value are stored in the stack before it is called, so the function is called, or they are just the memory register?
The register values, that's... the answer is I don't know. There's a contract with each register value, so clearly you can see that the callee is going to clobber EAX, right? So before you call a function, if you have any important data stored in EAX, you got to move it because it's going to go away. The other registers, I believe, yeah, I think it depends. Every register, I think it's defined whether a function before it uses it will store it and then use it again, so that I don't know.
Okay, so if we want to use one of the registers inside the function, then we can if it is removed, then can we use it again inside the function? Or
as long as we, as we'll see, we have to do the same thing we're doing with the frame pointer. We have to store it on the stack at the beginning, use it, and then before we return, put that value that's on the stack back in the register. So yeah, you can think of it like the registers are basically like cubby holes or something, and they already have stuff in them, and you want to put stuff in there. So you take them, you put them on the stack in a certain order, and that way when you're done, you put them back all in the right location so that it looks like you were never there.
And which,
question?
Sorry.
There's instructions, push add and pop add, and can push all of the 6 GPRs from the stack in case, the caller wants to use it and contain some information.
Yeah, the compilers the compilers are very good about optimizing those kind of things. So they will, if they can use only the EAX register, they'll only use that so they don't need to store any other registers, or which you can actually see in our little snippet, right? Because we don't use any registers besides EAX. But yeah, there's all kinds of functions and all that stuff. You have a question?
ESB is for the compiler, then. We're using the frame pointer all the time, right?
Say it again?
We're not using the stack pointer at all. We're using the frame pointer.
We use the stack. So for referencing our local variables, and as we'll see, our arguments, we use offsets of the frame pointer.
Yeah, but not ESB.
Correct. But there's weird things. Compilers will sometimes optimize. I don't know. I don't want to get into it, but sometimes you'll see weird things. You'd think before you call the function, you'd see a bunch of pushes, so you push the arguments onto the stack. But oftentimes they move onto the stack because they have pre-allocated space on the stack, so they know they can use that to push values in there. So they don't actually push anything; it's like a move into the there.
Yes.
Cool. All right. So we can look at this. So we will look through this. So we have. Very short C code, we have int main with a local variable int a. We say a is equal to callee, which is a function call of passing parameters 10 and 40. Then we return a. Then in our callee function, we have int callee, int a, int b, and then return a plus b plus 1. So this is just our very simple function just to show exactly what happens. So here, I'm going to show the main, all the assembly code from main and from callee from whenever I did this. So the main function is push EBP, move stack pointer into EBP, subtract 18 hex from ESP, move hex 28 into ESP plus 4, move 10 into ESP, which is actually an example of what I was just talking about, how they're not pushing, then call callee, then move EAX into EBP minus 4, move EBP minus 4 into EAX, leave, and then return. So we can see that the first three instructions, push EBP, move stack pointer to EBP, subtract 18 from the stack pointer, these are all a function prolog. So almost every single function will have, unless the compiler can optimize these out, will have essentially these same three instructions. So what's the very first one? What's push EBP doing?
Pushing the EBP
So it's saving the person who calls its base pointer onto the stack so it can return it later. Then the move stack pointer into the base pointer is setting up its base pointer for its function. And the subtraction of the stack pointer is allocating memory on the stack for local variables. And as we can already see, it's essentially pre-allocating it for future stack operations to call functions. So we also have an epilogue. So the leave and return at the very end here, you can think of, we'll go into exact details on what they do. Leave essentially is a move the base pointer into the stack pointer. So put the stack back where the current base pointer is, which completely does the last two, completely reverses the last two instructions inside the prolog. So because after this instruction, the base pointer and the stack pointer are going to be at the, oh, and then it does a pop EDP. That's right. It does a pop EDP, which then actually does all of these. Yeah, that's right. It completely does all of these, so it puts the base pointer back what was on the stack of the previous frames. We'll look at it in a second. And return, as we'll see, transfers instruction to the function that called it. So callee, similarly, push EDP, move stack pointer to the base pointer. Interestingly enough, so it doesn't have a subtract whatever from ESP. Why is that? There's no local variables. We actually don't need any local variables here. So why allocate, why do an instruction you don't have to do? So then we're going to move EDP plus C. So EDP plus C, then what is that likely to be? So if EDP minus something was what? Local variable, then EDP plus something. Arguments. Yeah, it's going to be arguments. So move EDP plus C into EAX. Move EDP plus 8 into EDX. And then this is where, what I said, you sometimes see weird things. This is a load effective address, EDX, EAX, 1 into EAX. What is that doing? Yeah, so it's essentially take EDX, add EAX to it, and then add 1 to it. So if you do that base displacement offset nonsense. So this is literally just like add EDX to EAX and then add 1. So it's like combining that all together in one instruction. And then, sorry. I was wrong. Okay, so this 1 is, you're right, you were all right, whoever said. Just add EDX to EAX and store it in EAX. So like, why is it not add EDX EAX? That's a good question. I tried this in a newer version and it did compile that out by the way, so who knows? Systems are weird. So then we have like an add constant 1 to EAX and then pop EDP and return because we're done. So again, this is the prolog at the top of callee, push EDP, move ESP into EDP, and the epilog here is pop EDP and then return. So you want to walk through it?
Why do you not have the leave in this place instead of having a pop?
Yes, so why not a leave instead of a pop? You could have a leave, but leave, essentially the stack pointer and the base pointer are at the same location, so part of what leave does is move the base pointer into the stack pointer to get rid of the subtraction of the stack of the allocation there. So they're already at the same location, so all you need to do is pop EDP, because that's the only part you want.
Of the main function, then it tries to return the EAX. It just tries to exchange the stuff from one place to another place and then return. So the last two lines, the last two moves are somehow the same.
Oh, yeah. So this was not compiled with any optimizations or anything. So hey, if you compiled it with -03, it would probably compile out a lot of these things. But that is some kind of optimization that the compiler decided I can do this because my guess would be because it's not actually altering our code at all, right? It's not optimizing our code, it's optimizing essentially its code, and it's because it controls the prolog and the epilog. So if it thinks, because hey, this function uses 0 local variables, then I can do my shorter prolog and epilog. That's my guess. Cool, okay. So let's look at this. We have, and these are all, so we know these instructions are all going to be at fixed memory offset. So you can load this program in GDB, or you can use object dump to see, because we know the ELF header specifies where all the instructions will load into memory. So if you look at the ELF file, it'll tell you exactly each memory location inside the program where all of these instructions are. So here I've essentially laid out instructions all by each of the, addresses by all the instructions in callee and main. And you can see, if you're super detail oriented, you can start calculating deltas between them to see the variable length architecture here. Okay, so then we have our beautiful stack. We have our registers. So we actually only use 5 registers in this whole program: EAX, EDX, ESP, EBP, EIP. And let's say we're at some, I think I actually tried this in a real operating system, and I was at FD2D4 when I did this. So this was the stack pointer. So now we just started executing main. So main just got called from somewhere. So the first thing it's got to do, this EIP instruction will constantly change based on what we're going to execute, just to be completely consistent, but I'm not going to talk about it anymore. Maybe when we get in the call. Okay, so the EBP is going to be something above us. We don't know what it is. We don't actually care if it's null or whatever. We just know that somebody called us. We've got to deal with their base pointer. So we first push EBP, which we know how pushing works, so that moves the stack down. We then move the stack pointer into the base pointer, essentially getting rid of the previous stack pointer, the previous base pointer, because we've just saved it onto the stack. So we know we can get it later if we need it. Then we need to subtract 18 hex from the stack pointer, creating space on our stack for our local variables. We then are going to move 28 onto ESP plus 4. So what's 28? Hex 28?
40.
40. So what was it in the context of our program? The second argument to callee, right? It was callee 1040. So then we have a move A onto the stack pointer. So now the stack, even though we didn't do pushing, the stack has, so at the current stack pointer location is the leftmost argument, hex A, which is 10. 4 bytes above that is the second argument of hex 28, which is 40. So then we call it, but how do we, so what do we need to do to call this function? Yeah, so we need to save the instruction pointer of the next instruction that's going to be executed, which will be, in this case, 80483BF. That's the next instruction. And what else do we simultaneously want to have happen? So we want to push that value onto the stack. But what else? Yeah, change the instruction pointer to where? The address of callee of 804.83.94. So x86 has jump instructions, which I believe you got pretty familiar with on the last homework assignment. I'm seeing some dirty looks, yes. There are a lot of weird jump stuff, which was fun to play with. So it's a call is similar to a jump, where all a jump does is change the instruction pointer to be whatever the target is. So in this case, the target here is 804.83.94. But if we just started jumping and executing from there, we have no way to get back, because the CPU doesn't magically know that it was called from somewhere. So call does two things. It essentially does push the next instruction that would be executed, 0804.83.BF, and that in turn, obviously because of a push, decrements the stack pointer, and then sets the instruction pointer to whatever that address is. That's all it does. It's not smart. There's no smarts going on anywhere in here. It's all very discrete, simple, in quotes, operations. So now callee executes, and this is the thing, this is why we teach recursion. It's the exact same thing that happens from callee's perspective than main's perspective, right? When main started executing, it had no idea how it got there. It didn't care who called it. all it knows is I've got to save this other person's base pointer because I need my base pointer. So I'm going to push EBP onto the stack, so save main's base pointer. I'm going to set up my base pointer by moving the stack pointer into the base pointer. And now, basically, as far as we're concerned, main doesn't even exist. Like, we don't care anything about main. It only essentially exists as a function frame on our stack. So you, another way to think about it is the function frame basically contains all the information that is needed to kind of execute that program, or that function, I should say, not program. Okay, now we're going to look at EBP plus C. So what's EBP plus C here? So EBP, so the base pointer is here. So plus C is, so 4, 8, 12. This is going to be hex 28. So what value is that? 40. So our function callee, our compiler, right? So we had, I believe, two arguments, A and B. A was the first one, B was the second one. How come it knows that at EBP plus C is the argument B? Yeah, so where's the first parameter?
On plus like 8, right?
Yeah, plus 8. Why is it plus 8 and not plus 10 or 12 or 4? What's those 8 in between? The saved base pointer that we pushed ourselves, and above that is the saved EIP, the saved instruction pointer, that the person who called us put. And we know that has to be there because of the C-Deco calling convention. And then the thing right above that on the stack has to be the first argument to our function. And then 4 bytes above that is the next argument to our function, and so on and so forth. Right? So this is how we can easily calculate for whatever argument in our function exactly how many bytes to look up. So just like local variables are all at EBP minus offsets that the compiler determines, in this case, it's not even really the compiler gets to determine. It's the C-Deco calling convention specifies how many bytes exactly above its EBP. So this is super important when you're looking at x86 code to remember that when you see EBP minus something, that's a local variable. When you see EBP plus something, that's an argument to a function. All right. Cool. So we can even see that callees function point, or sorry, frame is essentially all the arguments and all the local variables, and main also has its own function frame. So now we're going to move that hex 28 into EAX. We're going to move EBP plus 8, which is the first argument A, onto EDX. We're going to do a load effective address of essentially adding EDX to EAX and storing it into EAX. And then we're going to add 1 to EAX. And now we're done, right? Because we know that due to the C-Deco calling convention, the return value of our function will be in the EAX register. But now we need to reverse everything, right? We need to get back to, essentially, the stack pointer needs to be at FD2B8 in order for the function to continue executing. So we pop EBP, and again, we don't care who had EBP. We don't care whose EBP this is. We're just putting it back. Whatever value is in there, we put it back. And now we return. So you can think of a return, a ret, as the opposite of a call instruction. Or the other way to think about it is a pop EIP. So if it was a pop EIP, what would that mean? So take the element in the top of the stack, put it in the EIP register, and add 4 to the stack pointer, which is exactly what happened. So a return instruction simply does literally exactly that. Take that value, put it into the EIP, and yes, you cannot write pop EIP because that's an illegal x86 instruction, But if that helps you think about what a return does, that's exactly what it does. So now we're here. So now, from main's perspective, what just happened? EAX change, that's the only thing we care about. And maybe any global memory change. That
if any function we call or that they call or that they call change in global memory, those are now changed. But fundamentally, in our world, only thing that we care about that changed is EAX.
Which is pretty sweet, right? This is like, super awesome. So now we can just get that value out of EAX, put it into EBP minus 4, which was, I think we had a local variable A, and then we do this silly, like very silliness where we take EBP minus 4 and move it back into EAX. So why are we doing that? Like what instruction does that correspond to in the program?
So that it returns EAX, the value of EAX.
Returns EAX, there's no EAX in the C code. So what was the C code
equivalent?
A, return A, exactly, yeah. Because that was the, we said A equals call E, so that's this instruction, right? So we called it, and then we have to set our local variable A, which is at EBP minus 4, to that value. Now that we've done that, we can do return A, which is move that value into EAX. And clearly a smart compiler could remove these, but this is just a non-optimizing compiler here. So now we're done with the semantics of the program itself. Now we have the super important prologue. So now we're going to do a leave, which is essentially set the base pointer equal to the stack pointer. So yes, set the stack pointer, move the base pointer into the stack pointer, so move the stack pointer up, and then pop EBP to, wait, it must do a pop first. Ooh, interesting. Okay, I have it. Yeah, because it's returning. Okay, yeah.
Why was it doing that non-optimized thing again? The EAX into EBP minus 4 and then back?
The second move instruction is the return A.
Okay.
So to do return A, we know to return a value, you have to move that value into the EAX register.
Okay.
So the straightforward compile of that is wherever that memory offset is, in this case EBP minus 4, move that into EAX. So that's just like a straightforward translation. So you can think of it like the compiler is compiling like essentially line by line and not doing a global optimization or even a local optimization to say, does this make sense? Okay, so a leave, we're going to move the base pointer into the stack pointer. So essentially changing the stack pointer now to be D0, so FD2D0. So both the stack pointer and the base pointer are pointing the same value. What are they pointing at? The previous function's base pointer, right? The saved EBP. And then we essentially do a pop EBP. So we're going to take that value and copy it into the EBP register, which essentially sets up. So what is above? So where is, what is the stack pointing to right now? So my diagram, I have it all the way at the tippy top of FD2D4. So what is it pointing to?
EBP of the function that called it.
We already loaded that in. So the EBP is at FD2D0. So it's this FD2C0.
It's pointing to where the stack was before the main was pointing.
I mean, that is technically true, but what actually is it pointing to?
Five.
What was that?
The actual file.
The actual what?
File.
File? It has no concepts of files. There's no, I don't even know what a file is at this level. What's the next instruction that's going to execute?
Is that return 0?
A return. What's a return going to do? A ret instruction. Is the return, let's think about this. Is this return instruction here in main any different than the return instruction in call E?
No.
So
EID?
No.
Instruction that needs to be loaded to the AID.
Exactly. It's whoever called main, there's some function that calls main that when we return from main, we're going to go and start executing there. So it's actually like a lib, your exit code of your process has to get set and a exit has to be called, all that fun stuff. So that all happens here. So yeah, there's some address that you're actually going to go to after main to do the cleanup of your program. So that's what happens there, and that's what's at that address. All right, cool. So that was all background information to get to understanding stack overflows. But I think we've built up enough here that you can kind of see where we're going. So the idea is a stack overflow occurs when you're copying data or a stack overflow or a buffer overrun. These are all kind of synonyms for the same thing. The idea, which I know we definitely talked about on a Wednesday long past, is that in C, if you want a local variable of a certain length, a buffer of a certain length, you have to specify in advance the size of that buffer. And so what this means, and there's no automatic data checking on the bounds of that array. So if you're trying to copy, if you make an array of size 50 or a buffer of size 50, you can set values at 51 and 52 and 100 or even 1,000. Because nothing is doing that checking. So a stack overflow basically, or a data buffer overrun, exists when you can trick the program to write to memory that is outside of the memory that is allocated to your program. So this is actually a good, I think more of a good general definition, because if you think about a heap overflow is you can overwrite a heap buffer that's then, so if you have a heap array that's of size 1,000 or whatever, if you write over that end, you can cause problems. If you have a local buffer on the stack that's allocated on the stack of like 1,000 bytes or something, that if you overwrite those 1,000 bytes and you can write past that, that has problems. So normally this will cause a segmentation fault, the seg fault that we all know and love, right? We're trying to overwrite some memory that doesn't exist or is not allocated to us. But so we talk about, okay, I'm gonna ask this every time. How many people know it's probably a fable of Hansel and Gretel? Very few, yes, okay. So this is, I should have one of you guys tell it, but I guess I'll tell it. So the idea is, and this is the super abridged version, you can go look it up and read it, it's really creepy, especially for kids. Huh?
You're gonna leave out the witch?
No, which is a great part of it. So, except we're gonna tweak the witch a little bit. So the idea is, these kids, Hansel and Gretel, they live in right by a forest or something. It's this dark, deep, scary forest or whatever. And they start to go exploring the forest. And you're a little kid. All you have, you're poor probably too. All you have is like a loaf of bread. So if you want to go wander around this forest, how do you know how to get home in the morning or at night when it's super dark and disorienting and you don't have a compass? So how do you get home?
Breadcrumbs.
Hey, leave breadcrumbs. So you like take pieces of bread, and every so often you like leave a trail of bread, and that way no matter what path you take, you can always find your way back by going from one breadcrumb to the other, right, and finding the way. So what we're gonna, and the save instruction pointers on the stack are like the breadcrumbs of our program. Right? As each function executes, it leaves a breadcrumb to say, hey, when you're done executing, come back this direction. So if we were an evil witch and we wanted to, let's say, trick these kids to come back to our like witch's hut or something, one thing we could do is start maybe erasing those instructions, the breadcrumbs, and leave our own breadcrumb trail right back to our witch's place. I think I've butchered the fairy tale, but the idea remains. So we are going to overwrite the return value in such a way to trick the program to do whatever we want and to perform arbitrary computations. One thing that we're going to start off doing is we can jump to user-defined executable code. So if we can write to an executable segment in memory, and we can write valid x86 instructions, if we can overwrite one of those saved EIPs on the stack and provide that address, we can get the program to start executing some code that we injected into the program. And as we know, the key benefits here is that this code is running with the privileges of the running program. So if it's a set UID program, we are now root and have root privileges. We can do all kinds of fun stuff. All right, I guess we'll have to stop here. So good. All right.